Simon & Schuster Audio presents Defiant Hope, Essays on Life, Faith, and Freedom. Written by Michael Gerson. Read by James Anderson Foster. Introduction by David Brooks. It is not an exaggeration to say that Michael Gerson possessed one of the most important consciences of his generation. I first met him in the 1990s when he was working as a Senate staffer, devising a package of proposals to help the poor and the marginalized. He then went on to become chief speechwriter for George W. Bush. In that role, he wrote the speeches that rallied and ennobled the nation after September 11th. He helped design and champion Bush's PEPFAR program, which saved upwards of 20 million lives as HIV ravaged Africa. He then became one of the nation's most eloquent columnists. In that role, he was never content to do political horse race punditry, but devoted himself to the most essential causes of his time, pushing back on the authoritarian cruelty of Donald Trump and pushing for the kind of compassionate conservatism that he spent his life helping to design, champion, and embody. In short, he led a life of astonishing moral coherence and grace in a political world that bends toward cynicism and egomania. He became that rarest of creatures, an attractive moralist. We came to trust him to skillfully and authoritatively discern right from wrong, without becoming self-righteous, callously judgmental, or self-satisfied. He could be critical when criticism was merited, but deep down, he loved humanity. He loved God, he loved his dog, he loved his boys, and wrote touchingly about the sadness we all feel when we drop our children off at college. Some people are born good. They are open-hearted from birth, blessed with an outgoing nature, a warm personality. They effortlessly and volubly share and express the emotions of others. I always got the sense that Mike wasn't born this way. Nature made him a bit of an introvert, a bit reserved. His personality had a hint of waspishness. Disdain is a great quality in a newspaper columnist. But Mike rose above his nature and became a beacon of compassion, a man who saw the world with realistic but tender eyes. How did he do it? Or, perhaps more accurately, how was it done to him? My theory is that Mike's great act was an act of submission. The most obvious way to put it is that he submitted himself to the person and example of Jesus. The more complete way to put it is that, more than most American Protestants, he also submitted himself to the 2,000 years of Christian social teaching. He studied and learned to emulate the great line of people who, down through the centuries, were inspired by the example of Jesus to repair the world and bring us closer to one in which suffering is eased and human dignity is honored. Mike didn't just possess faith. He became a participant in a great spiritual and intellectual tradition. In this book, you will get a sense of that tradition. You will read a few chapters from a book Mike never finished about some of the men and women who formed this great procession of Christian reformers: John Wesley, Jonathan Edwards, William Wilberforce, and Olada Equiano. You'll read about the great causes they devoted themselves to: the Great Awakenings, abolitionism, civil rights, service to the poor, and opposition to authoritarian tyranny around the world. You'll also get to read some of Mike's newspaper columns. If you're like me, you'll savor being back in the company of Mike's voice. But more than that, you'll see how his own judgments and his whole sensibility flow from this inheritance, the accumulated wisdom of these centuries of Christian social teaching. He became strong with that tradition's strength, wise with that tradition's wisdom. He illustrated how submitting to a tradition can be both an act of humility and a source of quiet power. So what are the features of this tradition, and how did they form and inform Mike? This tradition did not provide Mike with a preset political platform. He got something far deeper, an underlying worldview, a set of priorities, an order of loves. This worldview and way of being starts with the great inversions that Jesus embodies. The whole Christmas story is pregnant with enigma and violated expectations, Mike wrote. The Creator pulls on a garment of blood and bone. Almighty God is somehow present in a fragile newborn. The deliverer of humankind is delivered, slimy with vernix in a place smelling of dung. The last shall be first. The meek shall inherit the earth. Proclaim good news to the poor and liberty to those who are captive. This tradition places great emphasis on the infinite dignity of each person, on the fact that each human is made in God's image. None of us, Mike continued, are mere skin and bones. We are skin and bones and the life of God within us. Even lives that feel relentlessly ordinary or hopelessly broken are vessels of divine purpose. We are embraced, elevated, and dignified by God's astounding humility. One of my favorite Gerson observations is this one: there is no such thing as an insignificant human life. A person who orients himself around this truth is going to have an egalitarian frame of mind. The ground is flat at the foot of the cross, and we see each other eye to eye. All human souls are equal before God and worthy of equal treatment and dignity. Such a person is also going to have a quietly impassioned frame of mind. Those of us who live by tapping the keyboard have a tendency to grow emotionally detached and cerebral. But this social gospel tradition smashes the categories of reason and emotion, guiding us to seek to understand the world around us by using the empathetic eyes of the heart, to probe the spiritual and emotional mysteries using the rigor of the intellect. A person with this frame of mind is also going to have a hyperactive conscience, making him acutely sensitive to the pains and injustices of the world, acutely aware of his own shortcomings. But such a person, like Mike, will also be propelled by a fundamental sense of hope, even amid hardship. In enforced isolation and loneliness, God is with us. In chronic pain and degenerative disease, God is with us. In a shattered relationship or a cancer diagnosis, God is with us. In an intensive care unit or a mental ward, God is with us. In life and in death, God will not leave us or forsake us. Those last few sentences of Mike's were autobiographical. It was as if the book of Job fell upon Michael in the final years of his life. He suffered from cancers, Parkinson's, depression, loneliness amid the pandemic, lingering heart ailments, even some dental woes thrown in for good measure. Bitterness, self-absorption, and self-pity would have been understandable responses to this cascade of pain. But Mike endured it with steadfastness, tenacity, and grace that all remarked upon. He was a man strengthened by what he'd read, experienced, and believed in, and his mind and soul were able to withstand the storms his body threw at them. It has been said that when you choose your community, you choose your character, Mike once wrote. Look at the people featured in this book, and you'll see what Mike admired and whom he strove to become like. John Wesley, whose Methodism provided community, home, and salvation to the working classes in the most brutal years of the Industrial Revolution. Jonathan Edwards, a man, Mike writes, who was conservative in tone, temperament, and deportment, but who was also a force for progressive social disruption. Dorothy Day, who not only served the poor but lived a life of sacrificial service among them. The mystery of the poor, she wrote, is this: they are Jesus, and what you do for them, you do for him. Chuck Colson, one of Mike's first bosses who ministered to the incarcerated. Chuck led a movement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.